Hello and welcome to this first part of developmental disturbances of head and neck. I am Dr. Pamuk Joshi from Aspire MDS. So this developmental anomalies, they can be of different types. So first type is congenital, there is hereditary, familial, acquired, hematomatous and idiopathic. So what is the difference between this all of this kind of developmental anomalies? Let's see them one by one. First is congenital developmental anomalies. These are the anomalies where the defects are present at birth or before the birth during the intrauterine life as a result of either hereditary or environmental influences on the fetus. Example is cleft lip and cleft palate. Other is hereditary developmental anomalies. So here we have two types, hereditary and familial developmental anomaly. So what is the difference between both of them? In hereditary developmental anomalies, the defects are genetically transmitted from parents to the offspring where the definite genetic location is identified. For example, in Down syndrome, we know that trisomy 21 is present. Whereas in familial type, the defects again here also are transmitted by from parents to child only, but definite genetic location is not identified. Example is diabetes. There can be acquired developmental anomalies, that is due to some pathological environmental condition. If the defect is acquired during the intrauterine life, these are acquired developmental anomalies. Examples include congenital syphilis, in which notched incisor and mulberry molars are there, or fluorosis, where enamel hypoplasia is present. There can be hematomatous developmental anomalies. These are the anomalies where defects occur due to hematomatous changes. What is hematomata? It is excessive focal proliferation of the normal tissue which is native to that particular region. So if in the jaw, if within the jaw you have development of a tooth like structure, it is a hematoma. Example is odontoma. There can be the other terminology is choriostoma. What is choriostoma? Excessive focal proliferation of normal tissue in the abnormal location or a location which is not native to it. For example, there is gingival salivary gland choriostoma. What happens over here is this lesion that appears like a fibroma, on histopathological examination you will find out a salivary gland tissue. So the salivary gland tissue is normal only for body, but its ectopic position makes it a choriostoma. Or another kind of tumor is teratoma, where the tumor arises from all the three germ layers. For example, ovarian teratoma. In this ovarian teratoma you can see presence of tooth as well. So all the three, ectoderm, endoderm and ectoderm, mesoderm and endoderm, all the three layers are involved, or the structures arising from all the three layers are present in the teratoma. Then there is idiopathic developmental anomaly, which indicates that the developmental anomalies where the exact cause is not known. For example, idiopathic enamel hypoplasia. What is the syndrome? The term syndrome derives from the Greek and it means literally to run together. So a group of symptoms that collectively indicates or characterizes a disease, a psychological disorder or any another abnormal condition. For example, Gardner syndrome. So Gardner syndrome you can remember as topic. So from T you have desmoid tumors, osteomas, multiple polyposis of large intestine, multiple impacted supernumerary teeth and multiple epidermoid cysts of the skin. So this is example of a syndrome. Now let's see developmental anomalies of orofacial hard tissue. We'll start with teeth. So in the teeth we know there is different stages of development. So first stage of development is initiation. If initiation is affected, it will lead to either anodontia or hyperdontia. So if initiation is stopped, it will lead to cessation of the tooth development, that will lead to anodontia. Or if the initiation is stimulated more, extra tooth may develop, that will lead to hyperdontia. If during the tooth proliferation, during the developmental stage, if it is affected, it can lead to either microdontia or macrodontia. During the histodifferentiation, if the defect is there, it will lead to amelogenesis or dentogenesis imperfecta. in the if there is morpho differentiation, it will lead to teeth with abnormal morphologies, either extra cusp or extra roots. If there is defect in apposition, it can lead to hypoplastic tooth. If there is defect in calcification, it can lead to hypocalcification of the tooth. And if there is some defect in the eruption, it can lead to embedded or impacted teeth. Okay, now let's see the anomalies that affects the size of the tooth. This includes microdontia, macrodontia, rhizomicry and rhizomegaly. What is microdontia? Microdontia is the condition in which one or more teeth are smaller than the normal, mostly seen in the females. The etiology can be genetic or it can be due to environmental factors. Now this microdontia can be either generalized or focal. Generalized is the case where all the teeth are involved, whereas in the focal cases only few or either only one tooth can be involved. So the generalized microdontia can be true generalized microdontia or a relative generalized microdontia. What is a true generalized microdontia? It is the case in which teeth in both the arches are well formed, but they are uniformly smaller than the normal size. This condition is associated with pituitary dwarfism, Down syndrome and congenital disease. Whereas in the relatively generalized microdontia, the larger jaw size relative to teeth, which makes the normal teeth seem smaller, is known as relatively generalized microdontia. So here what happens, that the teeth in general are of normal size only, but the jaws are larger than the actual jaw size, that will lead to relatively generalized microdontia. Now this kind of microdontia is, it happens due to hereditary condition. We know that jaw and teeth, a child gets the jaw and teeth from the mother and from father. So if the jaw size has come from father, for example, and teeth size has come from the mother, if the father has a larger jaw but the mother has a smaller teeth, in that case in the large jaw small teeth will be positioned. So this will lead to a relatively generalized microdontia. So that is generalized microdontia, true and relative. And then there is focal microdontia, that is one or more teeth are smaller than the normal. It is more commonly seen than the generalized microdontia and frequently involves maxillary lateral incisors and maxillary third molars. Then there is macrodontia, also known as megalodontia, the condition in which one or more teeth are larger than the normal. This is seen more in males as compared to the microdontia that was in female. The teeth are also known as mega or megalodont. The types includes here also true generalized macrodontia or relative generalized macrodontia, as well as localized macrodontia. True generalized macrodontia is seen when all the teeth in both the arches well formed but larger in the size, as seen in pituitary gigantism. Here you can see larger size teeth are there, that has also caused the crowding. In the relative generalized macrodontia, as we had seen, same reason as in the generalized microdontia, that is relative, small jaw size as compared to larger tooth size, that will lead to this problem, and you will also see crowding of the teeth. It is also hereditary condition. And localized macrodontia can be seen in one or more teeth that are larger than the size. It is also in facial hemihypertrophy. So here you can see a case of facial hemihypertrophy where the right side of the patient's face is having hemifacial hypertrophy. This is cast of the patient where you can see the size of the tooth. If you compare on both the sides, this side's size of the tooth is larger than the size of the tooth on left side. So this condition also involves the tongue, where the size of the tongue will be more or enlarged on one side as compared to the other side, as well as it will also involve the mandible as well as maxilla. Okay, so this is facial hemihypertrophy will also show focal macrodontia in these cases. Then comes rhizomicry. What is rhizomicry? It is condition where root of the teeth are smaller than the normal. The macrodontia and microdontia was about the tooth size in general, whereas rhizomicry is about the roots of the tooth. So teeth most commonly affected here are maxillary lateral incisor, maxillary third molar and maxillary and mandibular first premolars. In this case, involved tooth cannot be used as anchorage and abutment in ortho and prosthodontics, whereas in rhizomegaly these conditions where root of the teeth is larger than the normal. So most commonly affected teeth are maxillomandibular cuspids. Obviously, the clinical significance is that they may be difficult to extract and they can lead to oroenteral fistula. This was about the developmental disorders that affect the size of the tooth. Now let's see the developmental disturbances that affects the numbers of the tooth being different. So these ones include anodontia, supernumerary tooth, pre-deciduous dentition and post-permanent dentition. Anodontia is a condition in which there is absence of teeth in the oral cavity. It can be hereditary, familial, related to radiation injury in the developing tooth germs, hereditary ectodermal dysplasia or mutation. So the anodontia can be true anodontia, false anodontia or pseudo anodontia. True anodontia again can be total or partial. If it is partial, it can be hypodontia or oligodontia. Now let's see them one by one. True anodontia is a condition which occurs due to failure of developmental of the tooth in the jaw bones. It can be total or partial. Total anodontia is a congenital absence of all the teeth. It is a rare condition. Partial anodontia is condition where the congenital absence of one or more teeth is there. It is commonly, the teeth commonly affected are third molar, lateral incisor and second premolar. So most common affected is third, second most is lateral incisor and the third most is second premolars. They can be this partial anodontia can be hypodontia or oligodontia. If there is congenital absence of more than one but less than six teeth are missing, we'll call it as hypodontia. But if it is more than six teeth are missing but not all are missing, in that case we'll call it as oligodontia. If all are missing, we'll call it as total anodontia. The conditions and syndromes associated with anodontia include hereditary ectodermal dysplasia, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, Rieger syndrome, Down syndrome and Book syndrome. In pseudoanodontia, there is another condition. It is condition in which teeth is present within the jaw but they are not erupted. This includes the impacted and embedded kind of tooth. And then there is false anodontia, in which the teeth are missing in the oral cavity because they have been extracted or they have exfoliated. Okay. Now there is supernumerary teeth, in which the number of teeth is in excess to the normal number of teeth in the dental arch. They can be accessory due to accessory tooth bud, either due to splitting of the regular normal tooth bud. They can be hereditary or in the presence of atavism. So the supernumerary teeth can be either single or multiple. The single teeth can be a conical shape, can be complex or compound odontome that is erupted. They can be tuberculate shape or they can be supplemental, that is same as the present tooth. If they are multiple, we have to see whether they are associated with any syndrome or they are not associated with any syndrome. So based on location, they can be classified as mesiodens, distomolar or paramolar. The mesiodens, that is most common type of supernumerary teeth, is a conical tooth present between the central incisors, maxillary central incisors, that is small conical in shape. It may be erupted, it may be impacted or it may be inverted. Distomolars are small rudimentary tooth located distal to the third molar in the dental arch, and the paramolars, they are small rudimentary tooth located on the buccal or lingual aspect of the normal molars or premolar area. They occur most commonly in the maxilla. The clinical significance is that these teeth will cause crowding, malocclusion or aesthetic problems. It may lead to increased incidence of dental caries, and from impacted tooth a dentigerous cyst may even develop. So usually they should be extracted if they are causing any problem. The condition associated with this supernumerary tooth include cleidocranial dysplasia, Apert syndrome, Gardner syndrome, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, Down syndrome and cleft lip and palate. Then there comes a pre-deciduous dentition. Now remember, the pre-deciduous dentition is not same as natal and prenatal tooth, neonatal tooth. Okay, the pre-deciduous dentitions is the condition in which the infants occasionally are born with structures which appear to be erupted teeth. Earlier it was thought that they arise from accessory bud from the accessory dental lamina, but now it is thought as a hornified epithelial structures filled with the keratin occurring on the gingiva on the crest of the ridge, and they are termed as dental lamina cyst of the newborn. Same way, post-permanent dentition is a condition in which several teeth erupt into oral cavity after the permanent tooth have exfoliated or have been excreted. Previously, it was thought to be a third dentition, but now it is regarded as delayed eruption of embedded or impacted of permanent teeth, or it can be eruption of multiple supernumerary unerupted teeth. Talking about the developmental disturbances that affect the shape, this includes gemination, fusion, concretion, talons, cusps, dense invaginators, evaginators, torodontism, dilaceration, supernumerary root, extra cusp, enamel pearl, and cervical enamel extension. So gemination is incomplete formation of two teeth resulting from attempt at division of the single tooth jump by an invagination. So if this is the tooth that was being formed, so during formation from the tooth bud, if there is incomplete invagination, that will lead to formation of a tooth with notch on it. So this will result in two completely or incompletely separated crown which has single root and single canal. This condition is known as gemination, usually seen in deciduous mandibular incisor and permanent maxillary incisors. The gemination consists of same number of teeth in the oral cavity. So if it is gemination where the complete separation has not taken place, number of teeth in the oral cavity will remain the same. Whereas in twinning, during the development from the bud, there is complete invagination. So two separate tooth will develop from a single tooth bud invagination. This is known as twinning. So there is complete and equal division of single tooth jump, resulting in one normal and one supernumerary tooth. So in this cases, the number of tooth in the oral cavity will be 33 because one tooth has become extra. Then there is fusion. It is defined as union of two adjacent normally separated tooth jumps. So when two tooth are developing, and from there if the fusion takes place, it may lead to fusion of tooth either in the complete form or in the incomplete form. So these teeth are fused at the level of dentin. Now this fusion can be complete where the fusion takes place before the calcification of the tooth bud occurs. So this from tooth bud, if two separate teeth were supposed to be formed, in case of complete fusion, a larger tooth will be formed. So in this case, number of tooth will be less than 32, that is 31 in the oral cavity. In case of incomplete fusion, it begins at later stage in development and may lead to limited to roots only. So only roots are fused in these cases. Okay. So in this case, the tooth number will be same as 32 if it is limited at root level. Then comes concretions. Here also the fusion between the roots take place, but it is after the eruption. So anomaly where roots of two or more adjacent teeth have been united by cementum occurs after the root formation has involved teeth, after formation of the involved teeth are completed. The causes include traumatic injury, crowding, and hypercementosis associated with the chronic inflammation. Then comes the dilaceration, that is it refers to sharp bend or curve or angulation in the root or crown of the tooth. The etiology is trauma, injury to deciduous tooth, or it can be idiopathic. So what happens is, let's say this tooth jump is calcifying where the crown formation has taken place and partial root formation has also taken place. Now following trauma on this tooth jump, there will be displacement of this crown. So the root formation that was supposed to take place from here, it will take place from here only, but because of trauma, the crown part has got displaced. So the tooth that will develop will have a sharp bend within its shape. So this uncalcified root portion develops by forming an angle that leads to dilacerations. It is more common in the maxillary incisors. The cow may be present at the apical, middle or cervical portion of the root, and the significance is that it will create difficulties if it has to be extracted or if the root canal treatment has to be done. Then comes a talon's cusp. This is anomalous projection or additional cusp. Lingually, on the cingulum area, it forms a T-shaped projection. If you see, it forms a T-shaped projection over here. It is common in the permanent dentition and seen in the permanent maxillary incisors, mostly in the lateral incisors, and less frequently in the mandibular incisors. This, because it resembles eagle's talon, that's why it is known as talon's cusp. The causes includes the local environmental factor and the genetic factors. So this talon's cusp may or may not have the pulp tissue within it, but if it has pulp tissue within it, and following trauma, if the pulp is exposed, it may have to be treated with the root canal treatment. So the restoration of the lingual pits has to be done to prevent the dental caries, and reduction of the cusp has to be done if it interferes with the occlusion. The syndrome associated with the talon's cusp, remember this thing, this is important for your exam. They includes the Rubinson-Tibby syndrome, Sturge-Weber syndrome and the Moore syndrome. Then there is dens invaginatus, also known as dens in dente, tooth within tooth, pregnant tooth or dilated composite odontum. So this is a developmental morphological variation that is characterized by deep surface invagination of the crown or root. So what happens is, as we know, that the tooth develops from a tooth bud. So during the formation, if an invagination takes place within the same tooth, the tooth that will develop, that was supposed to develop, in which invagination will be present. This invagination is lined by the enamel only. That is known as dens in dente. Presence of enamel lined cavity within the tooth led to appearance of tooth being within the tooth. So it was called as dens in dente. The condition is most probably caused by an invagination of the enamel organ before the calcification. The commonly affected teeth includes the maxillolateral incisor, central incisors and the premolars. Now this dens invaginatus can be coronal, in which the invagination is present in the crown, or they can be radicular, in which the invagination is present in the root. Okay, so let's see the coronal dens invaginatus. It is classified into three types, class 1, 2 and 3. Class 1 is a mild form where the invagination is confined to crown and it is within the CEJ. In the class, so as you can see here, it is confined to crown and it is within the CEJ. In type 2, the invagination is extended below the CEJ, which may or may not communicate with the pulp. That is, over here it has gone below the CEJ. And type 3 is extreme form where invagination extends beyond the pulp through the root and perforate in the apical radicular area without any communication with the pulp. It will directly perforate with the periapical area. And then there is radicular dens invaginatus, that is arises secondary to proliferation of the HERS with the formation of a strip of enamel that extends along the root surface. So from here this invagination takes place and the root reveals an invagination with the opening on the lateral aspect of the root. Radiographically, the affected tooth will demonstrate an enlargement of deep pear-shaped invagination that is lined by the epithelium. Clinical significance is that the invagination is extremely prone to caries. In case of type 3 form of invaginatus, it provides direct communication. The type 3 is, let's say this is the pulp space of the tooth. The invagination will directly communicate with the periapical area. So chances of infection is there. Okay, between the oral cavity and periapical tissue, direct communication is there. So chances of infection, we have to treat with root canal treatment. The treatment is early detection and prophylactic restoration of this invaginations. Then comes dens evaginations, where the as the name suggests, evagination on the tooth surface takes place. This condition is known as Leong's premolar, evaginate odontum, occlusal, tuberculated premolar, occlusal enamel pearl, or central tubercle. The developmental anomaly, that is this Leong's premolar that we are discussing about, is a condition in which focal area of the crown will show a globe or nipple shaped outward projection. It clinically appears as extra cusp. Now this cusp may or may not have pulp within it. It is common in individuals of Mongoloid origin and it is rare in white people. How does it develop? It develops as a result of localized elongation or proliferation of the inner enamel epithelium, along with which the dental papilla also goes or follows along it. The clinical features, it primarily affects the premolars. It is usually bilateral. It presents as extra cusp. It can interfere with the tooth eruption and occlusion. Sometimes the extra cusp may contain the pulp, and if it is damaged following caries or trauma, it has to be treated with root canal treatment. Shovel shaped incisor, as we can see here, are variation of the dense evaginators, where you can see prominent marginal ridges which creates hollowed lingual surface which resembles a scoop of a shovel. Then comes torodontism. Torodontism, also known as bull's teeth, and it was the term coined by Arthur Keith. It is developmental anomaly in which the crown portion of the tooth, this part of the tooth, is enlarged at expense of the root's length. So there is altered crown to root ratio. Causes: failure of Hertwig's epithelial root sheet to invaginate at a proper horizontal level. So we know that after the crown formation, the inner and outer enamel epithelium meet at the cervical loop, and from this point they create a HERS, Hertwig epithelial root sheet. They form a diaphragm, and at that point CEJ takes place and root formation takes place. In case of torodontism, what happens is that this cervical loop, which was supposed to take extension at this point, instead of that it goes quite down, and at lower level this extension takes place. So CEJ goes down and the root formation is shorter in length and the crown size becomes more. Okay, that is the pathogenesis of torodontism. The clinical and radiological features includes that it first of all, remember that it affects the permanent teeth more as compared to deciduous. It is unilateral or bilateral. The molars are frequently involved. The teeth usually are rectangular in shape, because suppose, let's say this is the molar affected. If it is going down, and from here if the roots are developing, so it is, tooth is mostly rectangular in shape. You will see minimal constriction at the cervical area, elongated crown and elongated enlarged pulp space will be there. There will be apically placed furcation area, and there will be exceedingly short roots. It is classified into hypo, meso and hypertorodont. So this is the normal tooth where the CEJ is there over here. In case of hypertorodont, the furcation area, it is placed below the normal, but it is within the cervical one third of the root. In the mesoterodont, the furcation area is placed in the middle one third of the root, and in the hypertorodont area, the furcation is placed in the apical one third of the roots. The syndromes associated with the torodontism include Klinefelter syndrome, Down syndrome, and the acrodermal dysplasia. Remember this, it can be asked in exam. Then talking about the accessory cusps, the most common accessory cusp is cusp of cerebelli. That is present on the mesiolingual side of the cusp. If the cusp is present on the buccal surface of the permanent maxillary molar, it is known as parastyle or bulk cusp or paramolar cusp. And if the cusp is present, a supernumerary or accessory cusp that is located on the mesiobuccal surface of the mandibular molar, will call it as protostylid. There can also be supernumerary roots. So supernumerary roots are known in the mandibular molar are known as radix entomolaris or radix paramolaris. So if this tooth, if we are cutting at this level, we know that mandibular molar has a mesiobuccal, mesiolingual and distal roots. If there is a supernumerary root on a mandibular molar located distolingually, that is over here, this will be called as radix entomolaris. And if extra root is located mesiobuccally, then it will be called as radix paramolaris. Okay, so remember difference between, we have seen this parastyle, protostylids, radix entomolaris and radix paramolaris. So remember the difference between them. Then there is enamel pearl, also known as enameloma, enamel drop or enamel exostosis. These are the white dome shaped calcified projection of the enamel located at the furcation area of the molar teeth. They may consist entirely of enamel, or they may contain underlying dentin and pulp as well. So this is the epithelial component of the Hertwig sheet, which may sometimes retain ameloblastic potential and from which they may develop. They are seen as localized bulging of the odontoblastic layer, and they form a small group of, they are formed from the small group of misplaced ameloblasts. Clinical features include that they affect both the deciduous and permanent dentition. They occur as a single or multiple appearances. They are commonly seen on the roots of the maxillary molars, followed by the mandibular molars, and the highest incidence seen in the Asians. They can be extradental, that is on the root surface, or they can be present intradental, that is can be included within the dentin as well. Another abnormality is cervical enamel extension. This is a triangular extension of enamel in this region from CEJ toward the furcation area. It is commonly seen in the mandibular molars, and it frequently involves bifurcation area of the buccal surface of the roots. They are classified into type 1, 2 and 3. So type 1 is the coronal, suppose if this is the molar, mandibular molar, then in type 1, the cervical enamel extension has a coronal enamel projecting just below the CEJ. This is type 1. In type 2, coronal enamel projects below the CEJ but not involving the furcation. So this is type 2. If this enamel extends below to involve the furcation area, it will be called as type 3 cervical enamel extension. This enamel extension leads to loss of PDL attachment and may predispose to periodontal packets as well as buccal bifurcation cyst, also known as paradental cyst, in which from this area a cyst may develop, as you can see over here, that is known as buccal bifurcation cyst or paradental cyst. This in more detail we'll see when we are discussing cyst of head and neck. The depending on the condition that affects the position of the tooth, this includes ectopia, rotation, transposition, inversions and transmigration. What is inversion? Inversion is when a tooth is positioned upside down, that is known as inversion. Ectopia is a remote location of the tooth away from its normal position. So when a tooth is positioned somewhere else, if a maxillary canine erupting in the nasal cavity or maxillary sinus, or as low as inner canthus of the, as above as inner canthus of the eyes, this is the example of ectopia. This you can see ectopic eruption of this tooth over here. Mandibular third molar erupting in the angle of mandible is also seen sometimes, that is also ectopia. Transposition is condition where tooth is exchange their position. So as you can see, the canine and premolar changing their position. The canine usually is present medially and premolar is distally. When they change their position, where the premolar goes medial and canine comes distal, is known as transposition. Here also you can see that this is the canine present medially and premolar present distally, but on the left side the premolar is present medially and the canine is present distally. This is known as transposition. Then there is transmigration. It is phenomenon of movement of unerupted tooth in the bone across the midline. So if let's as you can see here, these are the two premolars and this is the lateral incisor. Canine is missing, that is impacted over here, and it is crossing the midline. It is known as transmigration. Movement of unerupted tooth in the bone across the midline is transmigration. In this case, you can see transmigration of the right canine to as far as the left ramus. Okay, then there is rotation, where there is anomaly where a tooth turns partially or completely, where you can see this tooth being rotated. Here also the tooth is rotated distally. It is commonly seen in maxillary second premolar and maxillary central and first premolars. When we discuss about disturbance in eruption exfoliation, the ones include premature eruption, delayed eruption, unerupted tooth, embedded or impacted tooth, ankylosed tooth. Eruptions is that we'll see when we are discussing the developmental disturbances. So premature eruption is the cases where the tooth erupts in the oral cavity much earlier than the normal time of eruption. It is frequently involving the tooth or deciduous mandibular central incisor. If they erupt at the they erupted at the time of the birth, we'll call it them natal teeth. If they erupted within the first 30 days, we'll call them as neonatal teeth. The causes includes endocrinal disturbances such as adrenocortical syndrome or hypoparathyroidism, where you see premature eruption. Even premature loss of the deciduous teeth can cause premature eruption of a permanent teeth. Delayed eruption, where the tooth erupts in the oral cavity much later than the normal time of eruption. It affects both the deciduous and the permanent dentition. So this is seen in the cases such as fibromatous gingiva, where the gingiva is fibromatous. It will not allow the tooth to erupt. The systemic factors include rickets, cleidocranial dysplasia and cretinism. Local factors include fibromatous gingiva, cleft lip palate and retained and deciduous tooth. It can be idiopathic as well. Then comes a submerged tooth. It refers to ankylosed deciduous tooth. No, so let's say this is the deciduous molar. Let's say it is E, deciduous second molar. Now in this case, this tooth that is ankylosed, so it is not going to get exfoliated, and the tooth that is below this will also not be able to erupt. And in this case, the tooth that are present medial and distal to it, medially will be the second premolar that will erupt to its normal occlusal level, and distally will be molar that will also erupt to its normal level. So this tooth in between, that is submerged as compared to the surrounding tooth due to the ankylosis, there is a deciduous tooth. So it refers to ankylosed deciduous teeth. It frequently involves teeth or deciduous molars. The occlusal table of the ankylosed deciduous tooth is located below the occlusal plane of the rest of the permanent teeth in the arch, giving submerged appearance. In such cases, the underlying tooth may become impacted or may erupt either buccally or lingually. Okay, so this is the first part of the developmental disturbances that we have covered till now. The next part will be covered in the next session. All the best.